Thank you. Thank you for attending. I greatly appreciate that. I came upon this, you know, I'm really pretty passionate about this subject. And out here in Nebraska, you would think, well, minorities, not so many. And that's not so true. Let me see, is this working? Uh-oh, we're starting off on the bad foot here. Let me, here we go, okay. Don't know why it just started, but I will be discussing gifted education and the underrepresentation of minorities, and believe me, I tried to find a different word other than underrepresentation, but there really isn't that many out there, you know, in the thesaurus. My premise is that elementary school teachers are the driving factor when completing the initial screening forms, and their misguided perceptions are a flaw in the selection of students for gifted screening. Most states, matter of fact, all the states, have some form of screening to determine who gets into gifted programs and who does not. They vary to some degree, but almost all of them have one initial choke point. And somewhere along the line, someone has determined that elementary schools and somewhere around third and fourth grade would be the greatest place to start this. Is there any evidence that this is the greatest place to start identifying people by IQ? No, just this is how it just unfolded. And almost every state has followed suit. It's also along the lines of how do they determine who gets into gifted programs or not? It's done by an intelligence test. Now, why an intelligence test? Especially when there's many different kinds of gifted attributes, such as there's the musically inclined, such as there's the athletic gifted. There's many different kinds of giftedness, as we're gonna find out, and yet every state has only one quantifying way to do this, one observational, measurable way to do it, and that's through an IQ test. So of course, what do the great majority of students getting into these gifted programs do? They're intellectually gifted, which really hurts particularly some parts of our society, one of them being minorities. And I'm gonna kind of give you a course as to why that occurs, particularly minority students. Not sure why this is acting like this. This is kind of weird. The lens you must look through. Basically, I approached it from two ways. First is Horace Mann, amazing educator, stated, education is the great equalizer of the conditions of man. If we really believe in America that our system of education should be egalitarian, which is everybody has an equal opportunity, then we should pursue that. And I don't think anybody that looks at any research can sanely say that's what we're doing right now. I don't think you could look at our minorities, particularly African Americans and Hispanics, and go, yes, they're getting the same shake as those that are living in richer districts, those white students. Just simply not true. There's a plethora of research that's showing this, okay? So you hear all of our wonderful politicians, not that that's appropriate tonight, but you hear John F. Kennedy, who most people would consider to be one of our greatest presidents, talk about education is the great equalizer. I put it together a video of somebody who did a research on what teachers can do. Literally, the Department of Education secretary said recently teachers can walk on water. They can literally walk on water, so now teachers are, you know, equal to Jesus Christ. This kind of stuff is insane. It really is. So if we look at this and say, is that a true statement, then we have to look at the products that we're sending out there. And we are absolutely not doing that. So that's one consideration. The other, diversity of our country is a strength. And therefore, we must make a concerted effort to include all groups. We need to be more inclusive. I don't think any reasonable person would argue against that. Yet, the statistics you'll see tonight clearly show that's definitely not the case. It's sad that we all come from different places. There's nobody in this room that can trace their ancestry back to saying, yes, I came from the United States of America. Not even the Native Americans can do that. Okay? So if we accept the premise that we all come from someplace else, including the Native Americans, which trace generally the theory is from China, that's the most accepted theory, then we should look at it as diversity should be everybody's included. And I don't think you can really honestly say that's occurring today. Okay? And I'm going to sort of prove that as we go along here. How did I get this idea to cover this kind of topic? I'm going to give you a very short version of a very, very long trip. After I retired from the military, I went into business. After I went into business, I decided to go into education because teaching was really my passion. I love being in a classroom. That's where I really love being. And the first job I ever took was in Jacksonville, Florida, downtown, where, just to give you an idea, it was a magnet school. And what I mean by magnet is gifted students would go there. Kids that got, by Florida's definition, an IQ of above 130. And this is basically the government's answer to, well, forced busing didn't work, so now we'll do it this way. So they got a certain segment of the population to go into the downtown areas to go to school. And that's basically just another version of forced busing, and that's exactly what it was. So you had a certain segment of the population of this urban, very urban school that gift kids went to. And what groups were in this gifted education group? Very simple. Asians, Caucasians. Then, since the school was located in the urban environment, 80% were African American. Okay? So you basically had a student population of 80% African American, 20% other, and that other basically represented Caucasians and Asians. Now, I'm sitting in the cafeteria one day because back in the day, oh so long ago, teachers in Jacksonville, Florida had what they called cafeteria duty. And that basically said the teacher had to go with the class to lunch. And since they didn't have lunch monitors, the teachers would have to do that. So I'm sitting at a table with 10, 12 other teachers. And it's funny, when an African-American kid would get up and act out, and these are elementary school kids, so naturally they're going to act up. When an African-American kid would get up and act out, it was funny, every one of the teachers said, the mother didn't teach that kid right. That included the African-American teachers. Included the white teachers. And that struck me. So I wonder why that is. Then it got worse, in my opinion. When a white kid got up and acted out, they said, oh, he's bored. They were doing the same behaviors, doing what kids do. Yet, everyone at that, and it was a very diverse teaching population. It included African Americans and whites. They all looked at the black boys and girls as their parents didn't teach them right. But the white kid, oh, he's bored. And that got me thinking, how flawed is teachers' perceptions? Because I remembered the first time I was working at this school, we had to fill out forms on kids to evaluate them. And I was wondering what these other teachers are putting on these forms, if that's their perceptions. And I started asking just very basic questions of teachers. Some people would argue that these were gotcha questions. Maybe they were. But I was curious. I wanted to see just how far these perceptions would go. I would ask simple questions like, well, do you think there's more dumb African-American people than there are white people? Resounding amount of them. And these are people with at least 4-year degrees. Resounding, oh, absolutely. Asians are the smartest by far. So I started doing some research. Guess what I found out? There are just as many dumb Asians as there is whites, as there is African Americans. And the converse is true. There's just as many genius African Americans as there are white African. The percentage is held true. It's a statistical absolute. All the research shows, qualified research shows, that there's just as many smart African Americans as there are white. So I'm wondering where these perceptions are being pervaded through. How, what, why are they, these are reasonably educated people. What's going on here? That's what got me to my study. Because I looked in my classroom. In the morning, I would teach a gifted class. In the afternoon, I would teach a regular class. The regular class, 100% African American. The morning class, which was my magna class, no African Americans. All Asians, all whites. How can this be? So there's not one African American with an IQ over 130 in the greater Jacksonville area. This cannot be. This is not possible. So that's how I came about my study. And here are some of the results. Now what I have done is got some research done and said, well, why would people in Nebraska truly care about what's going on in Florida? You can extrapolate it out and go, what's happening in one city in America is very identical to what's happening in other cities. You could easily do that. But I decided to do some research. Excuse me, for some reason I'm very dry. And the question becomes, how does Nebraska fit into the study that was done in Jacksonville, Florida? We must first look at some data to see if this issue affects Nebraska. More specifically, population data. Which direction are we going in? In the mid-1990s, the United States Census Bureau projected Nebraska's minority population would reach 14.4% of the total population in the state by the year 2025. That's what they projected. And these are all mathematicians. These are people that know this stuff. Okay? However, by 2014, Nebraska's minority population was already 17.4. Kind of overshot that target in a big way. So Nebraska's minority population is absolutely growing, way faster than anybody projected. That right there should tell you this is going to start to affect this state more than you think. And God bless the students I teach. I love them all. But I love when they say, well, I plan to work in the rural western part, so I'm never going to have to worry about teaching minorities. Let me show you what's going to happen to that little theory. In 2000, the number of counties in Nebraska with minority populations of 5% or greater was 29. By 2007, that number had increased to 38. Here's a visual representation. This was done in 2013. And if you would look, now what really bothered me was I couldn't find a map that gave you such a wonderful visual representation before this. But you would see there would be like no minorities here. And where would you guess that they would mostly be? Omaha and Lincoln. It was like right here, almost all of them, but they didn't have a map for it. And then it's been a slowly westward migration. So now how's your chances of teaching a minority student? Getting a lot better. And if the projections are showing, you're going to be dealing with them. Okay. So, what is the concern? Nebraska's population is becoming increasingly diverse. 15.5% of the total population in 2007. By the 2014 census, it was 17.4%. Hispanics were the largest minority group at 7.5% of the state population by 2007. And by 2014, 10% of Nebraska is Hispanic. The population is definitely changing and it's becoming more diverse in Nebraska. African Americans were the second largest minority group at 4% of the state's population. By 2014, it was almost 5%. The only population that has gone down in the state of Nebraska, which I didn't think was apropos to this study and conversation that we're having tonight, is the Asian population. It went from 2.7 to 2.4. Okay. So, underrepresented. Let's take a look at that. By using 2010 data, minority students and gifted programs in the state of Nebraska, African American, 3.35%. 4.9% of the general population of Nebraska. Now here's a theory for you. If we were correctly aligning populations with their general population figures, which is a pretty good rule of thumb, because you would think that the statistics hold true. If there's 4.9% of the population is African American, shouldn't that be representative of what's in the gifted program? Pretty sound theory, but it's not. The national average is 9.2%. Hispanics, 4.32%, 10.2% of the general population. So it's literally half as representative. The national percentage is 12.9%. So it's significantly out of whack. There's definitely something wrong. And I think I've uncovered it. Underrepresented continued. The data shows there is a clear disparity of the numbers in minorities and gifted programs based on the previous slides, and those are all census data. This is not, I came out of this site from somewhere. This is all US government census data information. Nebraska Association for the Gifted Conference of 2013, chaired by the Education Department Coordinator, Ms. Carol Rem, and two professors, met and arrived at the following conclusions. Minorities are significantly underrepresented in the gifted education program. Most people would go, well, duh. That seems rather obvious. Didn't need to have a conference to figure that out. They concluded there were three reasons. Identification procedures. This goes right back to the teacher. This goes right back to the elementary school teachers. No offense to them, but they are the ones that are doing a heavy burden of the lifting here. Teacher principal training. If you don't know what you should be looking for, why would you be required to fill out a form asking to look for those things? Kind of crazy. Lack of cultural competence. That goes back to training. Understanding some cultural traits that are endemic within subgroups of our minorities. My study confirmed the exact same three reasons 5 years before this conference ever convened. It literally matched it point for point. And I did this 5 years before they ever convened. Some of the archive data, looking back even further. The five previous years of data in my study revealed the following population figures in gifted programs. 9.8% to 11.6% overrepresentation of Asians. There we are talking about yet another cultural statistic that's definitely skewed. And I can't tell you how many people I hear, and by the way, my wife is from Asia, so I guess she should either be insulted or happy, I'm not sure, that would tell you, oh no, it's clear Asians are far superior than any other group. It's not true, but they are overrepresented. What's causing that? Why are they overrepresented by that significant amount? And by the way, this is for Florida. In what data I could find from other states that are comparable to Florida in terms of ethnic populations and really close data, it almost was perfectly right across the board, somewhere around 10% overrepresentation of Asians. They have the same amount of smart people as every other ethnic group. Why? That's the question I kept asking myself. 1.6 to 2% overrepresentation of multiracial. 7 to 9% overrepresentation of white, Caucasian. 17.8% underrepresentation of African Americans. And just so you know, the data actually gets better as you come closer to this year. So that's a good sign. That's a good thing. You know, it was 17.8 like 10 years ago, and it was 3.8 like maybe 3 years ago. 5 years ago. So I guess it's heading in the right direction, so that's a ray of hope. 3.2 to 16.9% underrepresentation of Hispanics, and there's no clear trend at all. It is an absolute mess of data. The range shows all over the place. There's really no rhyme or reason to the Hispanic population. There is no trend. So why is all this occurring? What is meant by gifted? In Nebraska, learners with high ability is what they call them. And every state loves to spin off this high ability, high achievers, big goal setters. I actually think one of them actually referred to them as brilliant. Okay? But you'll hear all these different spins on high ability. There's like, forget it, it's like crazy amounts. But rule three, and this is quite significant, last changed in 1998. I actually had to triple check that because I said there's no way they're going to keep a working definition of gifted from how long ago is that? 17, 18 years? There's no way. Yeah, there's a way. But here's the actual definition according to Rule 3. A student who gives evidence of high performance capability in such areas as intellectual, creative, or artistic capacity, or in specific academic fields, and who requires accelerated or differentiated curriculum programs in order to develop these capabilities fully. Now, the reason I wanted to read this out loud is because it's significant. Creative and artistic is in there, yet go look for somebody that was identified as creative or artistic and then put in the gifted program. I dare you to find one. Good luck, because you'll be looking for a long time. Again, back to, well, how do we measure it so we make sure it's fair? We go right back to that intellectual test. And you're going to see why that's patently unfair, especially towards minorities. Some gifted education program statistics for the state of Nebraska. 203 out of 259 school programs in the state of Nebraska have gifted programs. Depending on data, and I really couldn't pinpoint it because it's rather sketchy, there is approximately 39,000 gifted students in the state of Nebraska, and there's no real one hub. It's not like it seems everything in Nebraska is like, well, everything's in Lincoln. It's not like that for gifted students. There's really no clear pattern of this. And you could find numbers as high as 43 and as low as 33,000, that is, depending on what data that you look at. Now we get to the questions of why. If you remember back when I said the Nebraska Conference said the three reasons, one was identification procedures. Well, let's look a little closer at that. The most prevalent way a student is screened for gifted programs is through a teacher's recommendation. Research, and this is easily 30 states, pretty sure it's more, but it's at least 30 states where I found it, over 50% to 87%, and a great majority, a heavy majority, was in the 80% range, were teacher recommendations. That's important for my study. That's very important for the study, because we want to target the group that's causing these problems. Not out of, oh, we want to bash teachers some more. That wasn't my intent. But it was, we need to fix a problem that's been clear for, if you go back to when testing was really crazy. I mean, if you look at some testing data from the 30s, I was saying, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I was saying, I can't believe we were this dumb. I just can't believe we were asking kids, and I think some of you in here could appreciate that, kids in rural Nebraska, questions that only city kids would know. And as educators, I think you would know what I was talking about, okay? So of course, the data is gonna be skewed when you're asking people questions that they have no clue about. And it gets even worse than that. When I was in a classroom in Jacksonville, Florida, and just so you know, it's like almost impossible to be outside of 50 miles to get to a beach in Jacksonville, Florida. There's almost no way. Most people that live in Jacksonville live within 25 miles of a beach, okay? I'm teaching my class one day science, and I'm talking about moon and the tides and how they connect. And I said, remember the last time you went to the beach? Not a single kid has ever been to the beach. 25 miles. I was actually 24 miles from the beach, the school that I was teaching at. Not one of them had been to the beach. Guess where we went on a field trip the very next month? My principal hated me for it, just so you know. She actually was, most people that she tries to get to come there to teach, she has to like beg and plead. When I left, I think she was like, oh, thank God he's leaving. But anyway, a heavy majority of them were in the 80% range. More specifically, most students selected for gifted screening occurred in elementary school. Again, trust me when I tell you this, I spent countless hours looking for research to quantify that makes elementary school teachers the best people to look at to determine gifted or not. Nothing out there. It's just, and don't you love when they say, well, that's just how it works. Okay, well, that's just how it is. It's like been ordained. Something has come down from the heavens. I don't understand it. But I've never, honestly, this is the most vexing problem I have is, and what's really crazy is a preponderance of evidence shows it's third and fourth grade. And there's absolutely no rhyme or reason for this. There's zero literature and research that can back that we're doing this, which is really vexing to me, very troubling, because I'm wondering why we're doing it. Why are we picking this age and time to do it? It's not making sense to me. The typical process is this. Teacher identifies a student with potentially gifted talents with a strong majority, very strong majority, ranging from 80 to 90% being intellectually gifted, not creative or artistic. Okay, not creative or artistic. Please note, an administrator, parent, peer, other interested party, even the student themselves can actually fill these forms out and nominate themselves. I literally had to tell a fourth grade African American girl, you need to fill this form out for me. And her mother actually got angry at me. She did not want her kid in the gifted program. Even when I explained to her the amazing benefits you get from a higher track system. She was really, I mean, that's why the principal was wanting to make me go away. I caused problems. I think I still cause problems. I have issues. All teachers are tasked with completing this form on every student in their classroom before the end of the first semester. If you're a teacher, you would know most of the time, even more experienced teachers would say, a lot of times it takes more than just one semester to get to really know kids. Especially the reverse of that is having the kid trust you. The ones that are some of the most unreachable are the ones that you have to reach, and that doesn't happen overnight. I can tell you that right now. I had three girls that drove me absolutely crazy in fourth grade. They would never want to leave my, I literally had to kick them out of my classroom like 5 o'clock. They would say, we don't want to go home. Some, I found out later one didn't have any place to go. Okay, that's what we're dealing with here. Do you think these people are going to trust you like that? Doesn't happen that way in life. It just doesn't. So what about studies population? The data in my study collected showed the following attributes. And these are the people that actually took the survey that I based my study on. 73.4% of teachers were white, 18% were African American. In Nebraska, 97% of teachers are white, 2% Hispanic, and they had 2% often other, according to, and I know that reaches 101%, so I'm sure that's like not mathematically possible. Even I can add that correctly, but that's exactly what the data had, and that was from the National Center for Education Statistics. So now you have, I mean, a very skewed white population filling out forms on minorities, and it gets even worse than that. That's almost a non-starter right there, but now it gets even worse. National data. Data ranges from 85 to 90% of all teachers nationwide are white. Who in here knew that? I was blown away by that statistic. I was like, that cannot be. I found like 12 studies that quantified this. I was amazed. That's like so skewed. The population, white population in America is what? I think 67% now? Almost 90% are teachers. That's crazy. Years of teaching experience. The average age of experience in my study was 13. Nebraska, 15, according to the Nebraska Department of Education. The average teacher has 15 years. Training. Here's where it becomes a little bit more interesting and telling, in my opinion. 5.9% of teachers receive training in multicultural and or diversity, meaning the ability to understand minorities, work with them at their level, and understand where they're coming from. That was in the state of Florida. There is literally no statistics for the state of Nebraska. None. Nobody knows how many people were even trained in diversity. Now, I will admit, you can start looking at things like, well, if the teaching average is 15 years, and the population, the minority population, is only now starting to come to where it's an issue, there's some good reason why they never had diversity training. They didn't need it at one time. Very valid point. Absolutely. No doubt about that. So, I will not discuss the regressive statistics involved or the specific math, because I guarantee you, when I started blathering, you'd be like, yawn and get out. I would, and I'd be the one speaking, and I'd probably beat you to the door. I mean, really, if I will be glad to show you my model, no worry, but I will not. You've done enough just coming here. I'm appreciative of that. But I will provide some numbers for the reasons given by the Nebraska Department of Education Multicultural Department Conference were, if you remember, these were the reasons: identification procedures, teacher principal training, and lack of cultural competence. I will give you some numbers on that, and I really boiled and scaled this down. Most significant questions regarding teacher perceptions pertaining to identification procedures. 76.4% of all respondents agreed that identification of students should focus on measures beyond IQ tests, achievement tests, and grades. So here's what you have working here. I will never forget a story of a kindergarten teacher that worked where I was working in my first elementary school. And I kept saying to her, how is it possible minority students are so far behind white and Asian students when they get to the third grade? The principal allowed me to teach third grade 1 year, and then she said, we'll never make that mistake again. I had them crying on a daily basis. Oh my goodness. But I had to get them through the standardized test. In Florida, the first standardized test is third grade, and they were already two grade levels behind. So the principal said to me, I don't care what it takes, you got to get them to pass the test. She really shouldn't have said those words. But anyway, I will never forget this, because I was like, how is it in 3 years of education an African-American student could be that far behind a white kid or an Asian kid? There's no logic up here to me. So I asked the kindergarten teacher, who's been there for 20 years, and here's what she said to me. John, the beginning of next year, come over to my room the first day of school. I will not even have to say a word to you, and you will know exactly the problem. And I went, what is she, some sort of magician? There's no way I'm just going to look at something and find out what the problem was. Just so you know, she was right. First day of school, I was over there, and she said, look at that group over there. There was 3 or 4 African-American kids, 3 or 4 white kids, 1 or 2 Asian kids, all in a group. The Asian kid was already manipulating 1 through 100 in numbers. The white kids already knew their ABCs and were putting together basic sounds. And here was a paraprofessional with the 3 African-American kids showing them how to hold a pencil. I just looked at it and I said, you're absolutely right. And the gap just widens from there. So when you reach a point where they're in third and fourth grade and you're having them take an IQ test, how many African-American kids or Hispanic kids have even a hope of passing that test? Oh yeah, that's right, 0. Okay, 0. That's a problem. Inferring talents such as athletic, music, artistic, etc., should be included. Teachers know it. There's linguistically gifted. How many people you know, oh yeah, I speak 7 languages. And of course you wouldn't say this, but you're automatically thinking, yeah, and I'd like to hit you in the face. You know, brag or show off. But they're just linguistically talented. I'm still learning my wife's language. And I speak like an 8th grader in her language. Okay, and I've been married to her for 35 years. I'm linguistically stupid. Okay, but there are ones that are talented. There are some that are creative, artistic, athletic. Imagine if we found measuring tools for these people, as 76% of the respondents in the survey said we should. Would our gifted classrooms look differently? I would major to guess yes. 61.2% of respondents agreed that, now this is crazy, teachers' perceptions do affect their identification of gifted students. Teachers freely admit they're the problem. They freely admit it. We know it. Okay. Training. The next reason given by the Nebraska Department of Education Gifted Conference concluded training was a reason for the underrepresentation of minorities in gifted programs. 2013, by the way. Nebraska Department of Education Rule 3 does not require teachers to receive training on gifted students. Doesn't even require it. Okay. Even though there's specialized training for this, and most states do require it. In order to teach a gifted kid, you have to be certified in gifted education. State of Nebraska doesn't even do that. Further, the state does not require professionals working in specialized gifted education programs to have gifted education training or be endorsed or certified. So what are they doing to the gifted population in the state of Nebraska? What most states do, by the way. We know they're going to pass the test, so why bother with them? I've seen it happen time and again. The smart one, oh, just go over there. I know you'll pass the test. I don't have to worry about you. I got to worry about you over here, my low achievers. And that's what's happening to them. Training continued. There are two questions regarding teacher training in my study. 91.4% of teachers who responded agreed that all teachers should be required to attend multicultural education training. 91% said that. We want the training. We need the training. The teachers are begging for the training. Yet only 33% agreed that all teachers should be trained to recognize gifted attributes. One of my questions was, do minority gifted students act differently than white gifted students? Okay, just so you know, the answer is all gifted kids act the same. It's kind of like all dumb kids act the same. Okay, significant majority of them, oh, absolutely, the minority gifted students would act differently. Yet only 33% felt they needed to be trained, even though they're required to fill out forms to identify them. I know I'm required to do this, but I don't want the training for it. But I do want to have diversity training. Huh? How's that meshing? It's not making sense to me. Cultural competence. The next reason by the Department of Education Gifted Conference was cultural competency. Cultural competency directly ties to training. My study had only one significant question. 94.5% of teachers who responded attended multicultural training. 94% did. This translates to a significant majority of respondents have the knowledge to recognize the differences in cultural learning behaviors. So now, tying that all together, most of them have the ability to identify multicultural. They understand different minorities, but they don't understand gifted traits. But they don't want the training for it, even though there's a serious perception problem. Because they said it. 61% said, we can't identify them. But only 33% care about getting the training. That's a problem. A note on cultural competency. The state of Florida, where my study was conducted, required gifted training of all teachers who are tasked with teaching gifted students, yet only 18% were trained to teach them. And by the way, at one time, they actually paid you to go to the training. That's how I got trained as gifted certified. They actually paid me to go to classes after I taught, I went to a class and I got trained. They actually paid me. Now, teachers have to pay. In Florida, I think I put that on here. Hold on, I think I'm jumping ahead of myself. Nebraska does not require any training. One could logically conclude the numbers are the same or worse regarding the education of gifted students in the state of Nebraska. Okay? So basically, you have gifted kids in classrooms that are not being cared for by properly trained people. And by the way, that's throughout the United States. Don't think Nebraska is like the lone one that's not doing it. Every state is not doing it. every state. As you saw, Florida has only 18%. And they require the training. In order to teach gifted kids in the state of Florida, you're required to attend the training, and only 18% have it. That's kind of crazy. Unfortunately, without the requirement of training, the statistics was not required, so we don't have any statistics on the number of Nebraska teachers who are actually trained in gifted education. So why is this study important? Why should people care? Since its implementation, gifted programs have had many problems in identifying minorities, in particular African Americans, for the gifted program screening process. There are many statutes and regulations for gifted programs at the state level, and these programs had better qualified teachers and a more challenging curriculum. If you know anything about track systems, you would know when you're in advanced classes, you are being taught a lot more than you are in regular classrooms. A lot more. Research on tracking systems nationwide revealed schools without advanced classes had a predominantly minority population, were not racially diverse, had less qualified teachers, weaker academic rigor, and fewer college options. I just described the school that I was teaching at in the urban environment. Significance of study. The lack of referral of African Americans for gifted screening contributes to tracking systems that have lower percentages of minority representation in advanced classes and gifted programs. It's kind of like a gap that begins at third grade. By high school, how big do you think that gap is? It's as wide as the Grand Canyon. The research on minorities and gifted abilities represented less than 2% of more than 4,000 articles reviewed since 1924. This is how much attention they're paying to this problem. Less than 2% of any articles written were about it. And that's since 1924. That was absolutely staggering statistic in my mind. Significance to people who are in leadership to change this. Currently, between 80 to 90% of the teaching population in the United States is made up of persons with Caucasian ancestry. However, the population is increasingly diverse, with minorities currently at 29% and estimated to be 47% of the total population in the United States by 2015. If you've ever taught a group that's not within your cultural group, you would realize there's a far gap between who you are and who they are. Training is the only way to get there. Okay? That's a significant telling right there. Very significant. Significance to school leadership. Provide research on teacher perceptions as they select students for gifted programs. Why are we not doing this better? Even the teachers admit it's a problem. Teachers who do not understand minority behaviors and characteristics may likely continue to promote the trend of disproportionate percentages of minority misrepresentation and underrepresentation. I don't see it getting any better anytime soon. When you consider most states don't even require the training to identify it, how is it going to change? It's not. Benefits such as leaders placing stronger emphasis on developing better pre-screening guidelines, leaders correcting ethnic group percentages in gifted programs so the averages compare to general population percentages, leaders giving greater emphasis on teacher training and diversity and gifted abilities. These are ways to solve it. We can get our tracking systems ethnically correct by providing training to the very people that need it to identify them. And we don't do that. We simply don't do it. Minorities will soon become the majority, and the public education system must recognize more contemporary views of gifted aptitude. Leadership has the responsibility to find better methods to provide access to gifted programs for all. I've even included some of those in my study. Viewpoints of the research. Some of the things I found out. A clear historical trend of underrepresentation of minorities in gifted programs. I tracked it as far back as about 40 years, and I just stopped because it was like the definition of insanity. I was finding the same thing over and over again, and I should not expect something different, especially if you look at our past in terms of diversity, in terms of accepting minorities. It's kind of self-fulfilling, isn't it? Kind of obvious. There are teachers who continue to use ethnocentric or culturally specific rather than universal principles in the classroom, even though Brown versus the Board of Education decision was over 50 years ago. we still have people using same thinking as they were during before Brown versus the Board of Education. It's a serious problem. Relevant theories of giftedness have been expanded beyond intelligence and have existed for over 30 years. Yet all states continue to emphasize intelligence on screening tools for gifted programs. Who's ever heard of Howard Gardner's 8 multiple intelligences? They've been out over 30 years. The Marlin Report actually came out in 1972. This is the government recognizing all the research that says, yeah, there's more than intellectual gifted. There's musically gifted, there's creative gifted. I can go on and on again. You get my point. Federal definitions of gifted have significantly developed, whereas state definitions remain narrow and limited mainly to intelligence. And I really think the driving reason behind this is their concern over how can we measure creative? How can we measure artistic? Yet there are tools out there that can do it. We just refuse to look for them or use them. Federal laws, specifically No Child Left Behind, and state laws have provided no incentive to offer quality education to gifted students. Okay? None whatsoever. It's not a recognized program. Again, my experiences, it's always, you're the smart kid, go over there and learn. I don't have to worry about you. You're not part of my standard test profile problem. Tracking systems have a negative effect on overall scores within a school and continue to leave many minority students without access to gifted classes with better qualified teachers and stronger academics in better schools with better equipment. It's just that simple. It's a matter of accessibility. It's a matter of getting them in the right classes. Yet the reach is so far. It's too far for some. The achievement gaps of minorities are mainly caused by poor funding and less quality teachers, among other factors, at minority-dominant schools. There are absolutely environmental factors that affect minorities coming into the classroom. We have to recognize that. But there are also places where the good teachers don't teach anymore. What I thought Florida did that was very tragic. At one point, 10 years ago when I first entered the Florida system of teaching, they had incentives. If you were a high achieving, what do they call it, high achieving, something like that, the best teachers there were, and you chose to go to certain schools, and when they said certain, they were really saying urban schools with minority populations as being the majority, they gave you a $5,000 bonus. They encouraged good students to go where the problems were. When the new legislation under the current governor came to play, they took it away. So guess where all the good teachers went? Not there. They had no reason to be there anymore. There was no financial incentive for them. Some stayed because they got the heart for it. But I'm telling you, it's emotionally draining on anybody. Consistently low referral rates of minorities for screening for gifted programs are due to factors such as perceptions and lack of training for teachers who are the main catalyst for initiating the selection process. And there is no doubt an achievement gap absolutely exists. There's no question that's part of the puzzle. But we've got to start somewhere, especially where we can control it. And this is where we can control it. The state of Florida, where this study was conducted, showed no difference from national averages in gifted population ethnic percentages. The state of Nebraska also showed no difference from national averages. It's the same throughout the country. If one believes the research that gifted intelligence is equal among all ethnic populations, then the education system has failed minorities in accessibility to gifted programs. It's really that simple. And the preponderance of research is overwhelming that says basically 2% of the population is what you would call gifted, meaning IQs at least 130 or higher. And there's no ethnic evidence that there are more Asians that are smarter or nothing whatsoever. Research indicators. Less experienced teachers are not trained to recognize gifted behaviors, a significant number of teachers preferring a broader definition of giftedness to actual definition of giftedness aligning with federal definitions, a strong desire for a better education, better identification screening tool for identifying them, and they can be developed. A majority of teachers did not know or were unsure if different ethnic groups displayed different gifted behaviors. This goes back to, do minority gifted people, children act differently than majority gifted, and they don't. Gifted is gifted, it doesn't matter. A majority of teachers believe there was no bias in standardized testing. That's shocking. Any teacher should know that there is. Any teacher should know that. Teachers do not understand gifted behavior traits, but showed a clear desire to attend gifted training. Teachers showed a clear misunderstanding of the effectiveness of tracking systems. The survey asked a question regarding the preference of how to define giftedness. 72% responded that they wanted the Jacob Javits definition, which included athletic, which included music, which included gift creative, far more reaching than just intellectual. However, every state continues to use a narrow definition of gifted and offer little alternatives outside intelligence when measuring a student's abilities. 68% of respondents believe teachers' perceptions do affect their abilities to identify gifted students, particularly minorities, for gifted screening. Despite well-established research, 55% believe gifted behaviors in minorities were different than their Caucasian counterparts. Questions to consider. 58% disagreed with the question that minorities suffer from oppression and discrimination of some kind on a daily basis. 58%. We're still at that level. If educators know their perceptions are a factor, and the data requiring basic questions of well-established research are showing half or more respondents not understanding this research, should leadership consider enhanced training for all the staff? Simple question. The research on tracking systems or grouping by ability shows a clear trend of lower overall scores. Yet a strong majority of our public school systems, 75% of middle schools, 90% of high schools, have some form of tracking system. Regular classrooms, advanced classrooms, gifted classrooms. 90% of our high schools offer that. Further, most international studies show our elementary schools are as good or better than most countries, and a great majority of our elementary schools, most research plays 95%, do not have tracking systems. Where we go wrong in international competitions is at the middle and high school levels. They have tracking systems. Our elementary schools do not. Why are we not changing? Pretty simple question, I think. At what point in our education system does tracking systems become a negative entity for all students? The screening form developed for gifted identification in the state of Florida is relatively new, as all states continue to refine the process of recognizing gifted students. A training program has already been developed for teachers where this study was conducted, yet is now out of reach for many due to cost, $25,000 in the state of Florida, $2,500. Most gifted education programs recommended by the state of Nebraska were about $1,500, but nobody has the incentive to go to them because there's no requirement to have it. So why do it? If I'm a teacher, I wouldn't. If educators were able to attend the gifted certification training sessions as they would other basic training courses such as diversity, would there be a better chance of teachers' perceptions being minimized, thereby having a more equitable ethnic distribution of identification of gifted students? I think the answer would be yes. Conclusions. The clear message sent from the federal level down to local level of education is a promise to provide an equal education opportunity for all students. I see it in every mission statement of schools I went to here and in Florida. Mission statements. Take care of every child, right? No child left behind. On and on they go. Do we do that? I don't think so. The establishment of exceptional education programs provided a major step toward the egalitarian promise given to all students. The idea that one standard of education fits all is simply not true. The ability to educate students, all students, at their point of access to new learning is paramount to maintaining the promise of equal education for all students within our education school system. if you can reach the kid where they need to get to from where they're at, that's the key. How many are really trained to do that? The theoretical framework of this study was based on the continued underrepresentation of minorities in gifted programs. The research cataloged many reasons for the lack of minority representation in these programs. The reasons range from the academic gaps prevalent in standardized scores to behavioral reasons why minorities are not selected for pre-screening assessment for access to gifted programs. Just like I said at the beginning, the kid in the cafeteria, if he's black, parents didn't raise him right. If he's white, must be bored. Must be bored. The online survey results showed educators wanting and willing to receive training in diversity, multicultural, and gifted programs. At best, approximately half the respondents in the online survey had knowledge of even the most well-established research, such as minority oppression. A commitment to provide educators the necessary training in diversity, multiculturalism, and gifted program should provide a better understanding of their students and lead to a better equality in our public school system. Questions? Please. Thank you.
Do you feel that the real issue could be lack of parental motivation to push their kids into gifted programs?
I would even go so far as to say, I will never forget, I'm not avoiding a question, but I want to make a point. What I have found is an eminent professor named Ogbu talked about acting white. It's actually worse than the parent motivation. The kid, when he gets to school, has a serious problem with showing him or herself true value because they're taught not to. As a matter of fact, if they show that they're too smart by answering too many questions right, they go home, they get into trouble for it. It's not only that the parents aren't motivated, there's actually, and this is done by a very eminent professor, his name's Ogbu, it's called Acting White. It was done over 30 years ago, and it's still true today. It's actually a step more than that. In some households, it's actually discouraged to achieve. It's part of the problem. It absolutely is. It absolutely is.
Training the teachers is kind of, it's not addressing the root of the problem. I mean, you can train the teachers all you want to identify gifted students, but you don't have the support at home. You don't have parents standing up and
absolutely true.
Up for their children.
Classes I teach, I tell my kids there's three main components. The teacher, the student, and the parent. You got to have that. If it's not working together, it's not working. No question, you're absolutely right. The problem is, what can we control? What can the education system control? Can we control parents? I wouldn't want to. Pretty sure you don't want to. Can we control the training that will allow them to adapt better to what that kid brings into the classroom, to maybe have him achieve better? That is controllable. Parents are not. Are they part of the problem? No question about it. Great question, thank you. Any other questions? You're not gonna let me get out of here that easy, are you? It wasn't that holistically perfect. I missed something. I said a lot of tough stuff there, I think. No qualms, concerns. Thank you, sir.
This is outside the box because you don't have statistics on it. What's the hypothesis on when you can actually decide if someone's gifted or not? Third or fourth grade is like chosen from magic?
Yeah. There's actually a battery of tests that they're starting to develop that does not require on some level of academic performance by the kid. Unfortunately, most of it's left-brained activity. So here's what you see. A disproportionate number of students that have left side giftedness going into gifted programs. There's very few, and I've taught many of them now, that actually are right-brained gifted because they can't pass the actual test. Again, I go back to how in the world did they decide elementary school to begin with? And how did they, you know, make it where the teachers, who are not even trained in it, are the choke point? which they are, a significant number of them are. It doesn't make any sense to me. Would I love them to see you use an instrument outside? Absolutely. Are there some? Most definitely. Some of them are very measurable. Like, for instance, let me give you an example. For athletically gifted, let's take that one, okay? You can't tell me that you can't come up with a measuring stick that says the average 7-year-old should be able to run in this amount of time, this amount of distance. And then whoever does one standard deviation faster than that would be considered gifted. Even an idiot like me can figure that out. Do they do it? No. Now, I'm not musically, as a matter of fact, I'm tone deaf, but you can't tell me certain attributes in music cannot be quantified to become measurable to show a musically inclined gifted person how to read sheet music. I mean, I'm really out of my element here. But I mean, there's certain attributes that should be key tellers to these different types of giftedness. Why are we not using them? The only measuring stick in any state is an intellectual test that's left brain motivated.
At third grade.
At third and fourth grade.
Are we too late?
That's a loaded question. I'm not gonna keep you here another hour, but I'm gonna try and give you that's the point of controversy. You've reached the point of controversy when you have a set of group that will tell you the earlier you get them, the better, because there's less problems associated with achievement gaps and teachers and on the variables go, and parents at the, you know, the younger, the purer the data, okay? Then there are others that say, wait till at least sixth grade. What's really crazy is I found none that say we should do it at the third or fourth grade level. Where's most of it happening? Third and fourth grade level. I have no answer for you. It's bizarre. It's really twisted. I mean, honestly, there's a serious group that has some empirical evidence that shows middle school would be the best time, and then there's some empirical evidence that shows really early. None where it's being done. I wish I had a better answer for you, but I don't. Great question though, and that is a big point of controversy. Big point. Two great questions. Do I hear three?
Are there any schools that just assume all the students are gifted and teach them all the same?
Not that I'm aware of, no. I wish there were, but no. No, even the school I taught at, which was almost all gifted, you had to apply, you had to have an IQ over 130. So I guess in that regard, but they already come.
If they're all in the same room, you've got gifted kids that could help pull along the kids that aren't.
That would be the ideal situation. Actually, there's a lot of European research now where they've done away with track systems, and they're actually showing that the school does better overall when you don't have track systems. What I think is really telling in America is on every international measure, we're either at or far superior when kids leave elementary school. They get to middle school where there's track systems. They get to high school where there's track systems. 30th, 28th. Now, I hear a lot of studies go, well, in America, it's the social thing that's occurring. You know, we are more free with our kids, you know, with the social side of things. But that can only go so far in the statistics. I think a real measurable trait and very telling is how are we so far ahead in elementary school, yet so far behind in middle and high school? And one really way is, think about it, no elementary schools have tracking systems. And where do we teach them to get along, work with others? Do you hear any middle school teacher saying that? You hear any high school teacher, oh, help your friend. Find a study buddy. Get out of here, that doesn't occur. Why? Makes no sense. Any other questions, please? Please, thank you.
I didn't hear Josh's first question, but you had mentioned when you were teaching, you encouraged one of your students to fill out the form for the gifted program, and her mother was upset, so obviously there was no parental support there.
No, it was actually negative. It's actually, it was actually worse than none. It was, she was working against her kid.
Do you think that is a huge factor in the lack of minorities in?
I'm going to speak from experience because I don't see any research that can validate this. But I will tell you, from working in two magnet schools at the elementary and middle school level, that what I find is most minorities parents, they don't know or they fear. Whereas Asian and white parents, they find out, they push. I know a lot of times Asian parents, they send their kids to outside of the district to get measured. Because they in Duval County, the school, the district that I taught in, they had a rule, every kid can get two shots at a gifted test. Free of charge by the county. Two shots. Very rare have I heard an Asian parent say, oh yeah, I didn't take my advantage of that. Oh, I heard a lot of them say, yeah, they didn't get past the first two, so I went outside and got someone else to test them. Never heard an African American parent say that to me. Never heard a Hispanic parent say that to me. And I'm not here to criticize, you know, the parenting skills of people. That's not the intent. I'm just telling you my experiences. But there is research that validates what happens to certain African Americans when they are trying to achieve. It's called pulling them back down. And that has to wretch at anybody's heart. That it just doesn't pass my logic test. I don't get why that's occurring. I really don't. But yeah, it does happen though. And I think it's partly they don't know, and then some of them, I don't want my kid in that program. They'll be around, I've literally had this said to me, they'll be around white kids. And you try to explain to them, they're more qualified, there's better teachers, it's better resources. You're giving your kid a chance to break out of the cycle of where you're at. That mother, if you would have seen what she said to me, we'd all have to go to church on Sunday. It was interesting. The word choice that some of the compound words she used were very interesting words. Any other questions?
How much do you think it sets a kid back if they don't get the gift of the label by third or fourth grade?
Well, you can directly attribute that to college ready. And when you look at the fact that, what is it now, it's up to 30% of our population has a college degree. And then you start moving that backwards. And then you start looking at the salary disparity between ones that graduate with a BA, high school, don't graduate. It's easy to see what happens. Easy to see what happens. The economic disparity, you could definitely point to with this. It's a real problem. And again, I'm not condemning teachers. I'm not condemning the education system. I'm just saying, this has been going on for so long. Shouldn't we take a look at it and maybe fix what we can control? Something to think about. Any other questions, please? Please.
Okay, so a little background. I'm a special education major. And so
God bless you. I always say that to every special ed teacher because I tried it for 3 weeks and I thought I was going to go crazy. I have no patience, just none. So God bless you, I mean that.
I've noticed that teachers especially have and administrators too, have such a push on the gift kids and then on also the STEP kids. So those kids in the middle are kind of falling through. Do you think that has anything to do with it? Because those kids in the middle may not necessarily be the special education label, but they may think that they're dumb or they can't accomplish what the higher gifted kids are. So, do you think it would help if we focused more on those kids?
Boy, you had a lot in there. Let me break it apart by groups. The special ed kids are currently being mainstreamed into this regular classrooms as much as possible. That's good and bad. It's good in the sense that they are normalized. It's bad in the sense that the general ed teachers are not equipped to meet the demands of that kid. Okay? And a lot of them don't know how to teach them. So if they don't have the support of the SPED teacher, at the very least, those special education kids are going to fall further and further behind. The average kids are really being not cared for based on the track systems. They don't work. Grouping kids by likability does not work anymore. It just doesn't. The research out of Europe is so overwhelming. Why are we doing this? It's like the definition of insanity. Keeping track systems perpetuating when we know they don't work is insane, yet we do it. My experience with the gifted kids is they're not cared for. I think this should convince you that they're not being cared for. Okay, that's a very real problem. Because imagine the amazing things that a gifted kid can do to our country if they're developed to their full potential. And I've taught them. These are amazing kids that can be doing amazing things for our country. And it's just go teach yourself with that textbook over there. It's crazy, isn't it? Great question. Because you have three very distinct groups, and it almost seems like we're failing every single one of them in some way. It's amazing some of our kids ever get through, you know? And again, I keep going back to just look at the mission statements. Just go to any school and look at their mission statement. Very hypocritical. And I don't think it's conscientious. I would dare say most people don't know this. So it's not like I'm blaming them. If you don't know something, how could you be held accountable for it? You know? So it's really a tough thing. It really is. Any other questions? No, thank all of you for listening patiently to that. Greatly appreciate it. Thank you.